regardless of his means, should have an opportunity for health care.
I will propose a program to ensure that no American family will be prevented from obtaining basic medical care by inability to pay.
We can conquer cancer. We can curb those heart diseases which afflict so many Americans. We can make this the healthiest country in the world.
Taking intelligent steps to make adequate health services a right for all our people. A basic concern shall be for the dignity of the person and not for the individual's wealth or income.
Americans have always been promised the best health care. To find out what most of us really get, we spent 6 months in Brooklyn, New York, at Kings County Hospital and Downstate Medical Center. We chose these hospitals because, incredibly, one out of every 200 Americans comes here for medical treatment. The more we explored Kings County, the more frightening it became. This is the only free cancer radiation clinic for half the population of New York City. For thousands of patients, it's the last hope. But the city refuses to improve the primitive facilities. The radiation machine is so old and out of repair, it's called the killer, because it destroys so much healthy tissue.
I don't see any difference between the killing of or slaughtering by the Nazis in Germany and the contemptuous neglect of the authorities in charge of providing quality and equipment to Kings County Hospital with thousands of patients. It isn't just a matter of proportion, but the net effect is the same. It's condemning people to death.
Across the street at Downstate Medical Center, there is excellent care for those who can pay. Dr. Bohorke also supervises cancer treatment here, but at Downstate, he has the best equipment money can buy. This is the New York City Medicaid office. Last year, 236,000 people applied for assistance, but almost everyone was turned down. A family of four must earn less than $96 a week to qualify. The Barreras just had their first baby. The bill was $1,200, one quarter their annual income.
Well, first, we'd like to know why this is that they refused us the...
Well, it says here, we have determined that your family's annual net income is $5,826.60, okay? We have an income level for people who are applying to Medicaid. Evidently, your income is over, is in excess of the allowable amount. So therefore, you have a surplus of $813.30.
I know, but I don't think it's fair still, because we just can't,
well,
no matter what, you know?
Well, we're not talking about fair, we're talking about a federal and state law.
I know, but my husband goes to college at night, 4 days a week, and he pays for his own courses, and another thing that we have is the car fare. We live in a double zone area, we have to pay double car fare, train and bus.
All these things, you know, right.
You're at the wrong person's desk now. You need to be at the president's desk or the mayor's desk or Carrie's desk, because they are the ones who make the rules. Sitting here, I am only carrying out the rules that were given to me to carry out.
Mr. Walker, a stroke victim, has been rejected three times by Medicaid. He doesn't know how to change their mind, but he has to try.
I'm getting tired of coming down. I was at the hospital Friday, and they told me Friday, Mr. Walker, if you don't have the card when you come back, it costs you $30 to go back to see the doctor. And I'm on disability. Now, where the hell am I going to come up with it? Go out and rob a junkie?
Do you have any card at all from the Social Security Bureau? When you get Social Security, they give you a card.
They do?
Yeah.
I don't have one.
You don't have one. Okay, that's all.
I never had one.
Okay.
What's it for?
Well, when you get disability for a number of years, they give you hospital coverage.
A number of years, darling, stay with me. This only happened last year.
Okay, so now you learned something.
Okay, good. But it's not a number
Eventually,
of years.
Eventually, they'll write you a letter and ask you.
When the time comes.
Mr. Walker.
Yes, ma'am.
Unless you straighten out that, we can't give you...
Is it straight now?
No, you know, you want a Medicaid card without housekeeping services? Fine, we'll process it accordingly. That's all. Okay?
Yeah.
Goodbye.
Okay.
Good evening. I'm Miriam Friedlander, City Councilwoman in Lower Manhattan. Manhattan at large, welcome. Tonight we're talking about a very important topic for all of you. You've just seen some pictures about people who came to get help for health. Well, sometimes health is the difference between living and not living either too well or not living, period. And we have just had a very special program projected by the Health and Hospital Corps, right? The Health and Hospital Corporation is putting out a tremendous plan. Only I'm not sure it's a plan. I'm not even sure it's a plan for everybody, or a good or a bad plan. And that's what our guests are going to talk about tonight. What is the health and hospital crisis everybody's talking about in New York City? And we have with us some very good people who know just what it's about. On the inside, we have Dr. Joe Merlino here, and he is from the Committee of Interns and Residents. And if you go to a municipal hospital, it's the interns and the resident physicians, yeah, who carry the main burden of what's going on. So he should know what goes on in the hospital system. And he's a psychiatric resident at Metropolitan Hospital up in East Harlem, right there. And we have here Diane Lacey. Diane Lacey has now become the representative for the Manhattan Council people on the Health and Hospital Corporation Board, right?
That's right.
But you have been associated with the hospital before. You worked in which hospital?
I worked in Sydenham.
Okay, and that's in Harlem. And that's one that was on the hit list?
Stays on the hit list.
It still is. And
yes.
Metropolitan's on the hit list?
Absolutely.
Oh, wow. And we have another person who is terribly important, and most people don't realize. So important is the municipal hospital system for the people, all the people in the city of New York, that a system was laid out where the communities elect a representative board of community people, interested community people. They go out, they spend money, run elections, and the community board for each municipal hospital, and they meet once a month on a regular basis, and they deal with every single aspect of the hospital. And we have Judy Wessler here, and she's vice president of the community board at Gouverneur Hospital down in Lower Manhattan, right, east side, and she's also a vice president of the citywide community boards. So we've brought together people who really know what the hospital system's about and how it affects people. I'm going to ask you, Joe, will you give us a shot at this plan that's been laid out? Everybody knows it's going to close hospitals, and they say it's supposed to improve or at least give us the services. How do you see the plan that's been put out at the mayor's request, this special task force, and now the Health and Hospital Board's voted on it? What is it saying to the people of the city of New York?
It's not saying too many things that's encouraging, unfortunately.
Uh-huh.
We're attacking the plan on three points: the fact that it's illogical and irrational, the fact that it's illegal, and the fact that it's undemocratic.
Is that right? All of that?
Absolutely.
Okay.
In a nutshell.
And if you're sick, how does that affect you?
If it's sick, well, that's just for the people at home so that they get an overview of what's happening.
Right.
If it's sick and you're unfortunate enough to have to go to a hospital,
yeah,
the effect that it has is that it's already taking impact in the city hospital system.
What?
Because of the bad press we've been getting, because of the low morale that it's created,
uh-huh,
because of the attrition policies that are being implemented by the Health and Hospitals Corporation.
What do you mean by attrition policies?
The attrition policies,
for instance, what's happening in Metropolitan? You're working there.
Well, I'll speak specifically
They've been saying we're going to close Metropolitan, not the ambulatory, we're going to close. What's happening now?
At Metropolitan, the morale, first of all, is at the base level right
These
now.
Are the people who work
the
there.
The people who work in the hospital,
uh-huh,
the nurses,
doctors,
the physicians, the ancillary care.
Did this plan say that they were going to fire approximately 3,500 people on a citywide basis if they close hospitals?
I'm not sure of the number.
Yes, many more than that. Many more than
what
that.
Do you think?
It's estimated between 9,000 and 12,000 people
are going to be fired.
Are going to be fired or dislocated. And of that, about 70% of that total are black and Hispanic, and most of them from lower level jobs. A lot of them older people, and these are people who may never work again,
uh-huh,
but certainly will either go on unemployment or on welfare.
So how can the mayor say he's going to maintain, or the Mr. Hoffman of Health and Hospital, say he's going to maintain service for the people in the community and fire that many people? Well, tell us again, what's happening in Metropolitan?
Well, the other thing that's happening at Metropolitan is that the publicity that's been out has been so detrimental that we don't have to sit around and wait for Mayor Koch to close our hospital.
You mean
he's doing it very effectively right now.
I mean, he's killing it off little by little?
He's killing it off lots by lots.
Well, what happens to people who are coming in and asking for service? I mean, these are a lot of poor people, a lot of low-middle-income people living around that area.
Absolutely. We're doing the best we can with the little we have to continue to give them the quality medical care that we've continued
to give. Well, what would happen if you closed it? Let's say you close the door, and the mayor says, well, there's something within 30 minutes of you where you can go and get service. What happens?
Yeah, that's the question we've been asking Mayor Koch. What happens to those people? We already know that the voluntary hospitals in the area, Mount Sinai Hospital, Lenox Hill Hospital, they're at capacity right now. Their census are running at 85 to 90%.
You mean they couldn't take those people that were turning away from Metropolitan Hospital?
They couldn't and probably wouldn't.
Ah, that's another point. Did you know that the figures are that those voluntary, now we're talking about different, not municipals, voluntary hospitals, these are where they're supposed to be non-profit, but the doctors make a big profit and they have very special kind of service and things like that. These voluntary hospitals have a limit of only 12 to 15% poor people that they accept, and nobody without coverage. So here we have people coming to Metropolitan, the door is closed, and they're sent to go to a local voluntary hospital. You close that door. What happens to these people?
They've got nowhere to go. That's the point.
You mean they really just go back home and be sick?
No, they can. They have the choice to go to an emergency room of another hospital, but if they don't have the medical coverage to be seen, they're not going to be.
They're not going to be seen.
Absolutely.
Or there'll be tragically long waits. Presently, the city hospital, for example, that would be receiving the people who presently use Sydenham and Metropolitan would most likely be Harlem Hospital. Mm-hmm. Harlem Hospital is already existing on a marginal level. It's suffered a lot of budget cuts, and plus the mayor is planning to cut $4 million from the Harlem Hospital budget. So that's a budget cut on top of being forced to absorb all of the patients from Sydenham who would normally go to Sydenham or Metropolitan. Mm-hmm. So that
actually they are cutting hospitals or proposing to cut hospitals, and there really is no place for these people to go. Now, who are the kinds of people?
Let me just follow up on what Joseph started to talk about some of the assumptions in the mayor's report. I can't call it a plan because it's not a plan.
Right.
Yeah. Some of the things that they counted on, they make assumptions that if a hospital now takes Medicaid patients, that they will take more.
Uh-huh.
That is an unfounded assumption.
Well, we know they're not doing that. They're closing the door.
Right. They make an assumption let's take the travel times. A lot of the basis for this report is that it's okay because within 30 minutes there are other hospitals, and they list, and they have 60 pages out of 400 pages that are computer-run documents that show travel times.
Right.
There are a few problems with that.
What's that?
Well, number one is that the travel time is from the hospital that's closed. It's not from the person's home.
Right.
It could have taken the person 15 to 20 minutes to get to that hospital.
Yeah.
That's number one. Number two, it's for the kind of travel time, a young, healthy individual. It's not
on
for
buses,
the old,
on
the
subways,
ill,
on things like that.
Women
with
children.
Old women with children, whatever.
Yeah.
Obviously, that
in most of these communities, you may walk in with four kids on your hand and still have to go. How can you afford to take a bus?
You have no one at home to take care of the kids. So.
Right. So actually, this is not accurate. As a matter of fact, I've been told that the statistics that they use for estimating the need to close hospitals is all false. You know, the federal government had a statistic saying you need 4 beds for 1,000 people. Well, they didn't count New York City.
They also don't know how many people live in New York City.
They don't even know how many people.
They count every other person.
In a community where you have a lot of older people, you need more beds, don't you?
Absolutely. The plan when it came out, and when they talked about 4 beds per 1,000, was an overall plan.
Yeah.
Number one, it didn't look at East Harlem or Central Harlem or West Harlem as opposed to one of the more affluent communities.
Right.
So, as you said, absolutely, if one community has a higher incidence of the elderly or of infant mortality or drug addiction or alcoholism, and another community has an affluent community that maybe gets an upper respiratory infection once in a while. They're using the same planning to take care of both communities.
And yet they are closing the hospitals in those poorer communities where there is greater need for help than they are in the other communities where you don't have as need. I think another aspect of that plan is very false also. I mean, first of all, the financial base is false, the bed base is false, the travel time is false, the fact that the people have a place to go is false. One other aspect which is very important, which the mayor has said, and Deputy Mayor Ward has said, and Mr. Hoffman has said, and that is that we are going to develop ambulatory care. We don't need such expensive buildings, they say. We need ambulatory care. Well, we have an excellent ambulatory care down in Gouverneur Hospital, right, Judy?
Yes, it's excellent. It functions very
now,
well.
Now, what are they planning to do with that excellent ambulatory care?
Well, they have this insane plan to hand over ambulatory care from the Health and Hospitals Corporation to the Health Department to run.
The Health Department?
The Health Department, 10 years ago, it's described in this document, and it's described as it was 10 years ago. It was one of the best health departments in the country.
Right.
Because of budget cuts and because of what I call incredibly backward priorities, the Health Department has been cut so badly that...
Haven't they closed all the clinics?
They've closed a lot of clinics, but worse than that, at the same time that Health Department doctors were proudly writing up in medical magazines the study that they did about how they tested people who had no symptoms for tropical diseases and the incredible rate that they found, you know, of diseases in people with no symptoms, at the same time they were closing down tropical disease clinics.
How many tropical diseases? Oh,
they
that's nice.
Three out of four clinics.
We have a full-fledged medical service in the Lower East Side at Gouverneur Hospitals. What they're proposing is to turn it over to the Health Department. Health Department now has tropical diseases, immunization, and VD. And a little bit of child. They have been cutting down on that.
Yes.
This is an inexperienced department. As a matter of fact, the phony part about it is they have estimated it will cost $4 million to transfer a working ambulatory care that meets 260,000 people a year.
There's also a very phony saving
in the
thing for Gouverneur, and that's that they say the Health Department can deliver the care for less, but the overhead for ambulatory care is going to be shoved onto the other service in the building. Gouverneur was a hospital. The hospital piece was closed.
And they're talking about the SNF
and
here.
They're talking about the long-term care facility, putting all the overhead on that, and making those costs so outrageous that they'll probably
talk about
closing.
So here we are juggling books back and forth to show that the Gouverneur, which is they said was their objective of ambulatory care, they are now going to kill that fine objective that they have placed there where they have a good example. Mm-hmm. By the way, this is licensed by the state, you know, Gouverneur, as a freestanding ambulatory. So they're going to kill that. So that's another false thing in that report, that their objective is good ambulatory care.
Plus, you know, at a time when everybody is talking about providing ambulatory care, calculations were done by the Coalition for Rational Health Policy that this plan, if fully implemented, cuts out access to 500,000 ambulatory care visits. 500,000 visits are cut out totally.
It doesn't increase out of
the capacity of hospitals
so
to serve
what we
people.
Are saying
and that
here.
Doesn't count the emergency room, which is critical.
You're going to be faced with a very interesting thing. Here was a health and hospital board that suddenly voted on a plan which was presented to them a week before. And they hadn't had time to even look at it or talk. As a matter of fact, I thought they hurried up because we in Manhattan, we had just gotten around to nominating Diane Lacey as our representative on the Health and Hospital Board. And I think when they found she was coming, they decided to cast a fast vote because they figured she wasn't going to be sympathetic to the plan. Is that it?
I wouldn't doubt that at all. We can't get into their heads, but I wouldn't doubt that. They know that the vote would have been closer, and I'm sure I would have been able to influence some of my colleagues. But I think, Councilwoman, we're saying some things that New Yorkers need to understand. That there will be no savings in this plan.
That's right.
And that if we really wanted to, we could make the Health and Hospitals Corporation much more nearly self-sufficient.
Right.
It is a revenue-producing institution.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And there are many people at the hospital level who have creative ideas that would really make those hospitals perhaps even stand on their own. And that's where the Board of the Health and Hospitals Corporation and the administration, I think, ought to be focusing their energy on collecting the over $200 million that are owed to the Health and Hospitals Corporation.
And they're really not working hard for
they
that.
They are really not doing it. They're not even negotiating with the state the way they should. They're talking about negotiating $50 million and $50 million out of $200 million. Uh-huh. And the mayor is saying he's got to make these life-threatening cuts in order to meet a $39 million deficit. That's where the energy should be applied, not to closing or transferring or cutting services.
Right. And when the mayor was a congressman, he held a hearing on the Health and Hospitals Corporation, and he sent out newsletters and accused the voluntary sector, the private sector, who work with the municipal hospitals, of pretty much stealing $60 million from the municipal hospitals.
Uh-huh. Well, this is very interesting because I think what is happening here, I mean, do you find, for instance, negotiations are going on if they empty that Metropolitan building, that there are going to be negotiations to turn that building over to the voluntaries? You know, we're talking about voluntaries and proprietaries. These are affluent people who milk the hospital system, the health system, and the people, right?
That's right. You know, the East Harlem community and the Harlem community in general is becoming very valuable property for the people of New York City.
Right.
You know, since we've got nowhere to expand anymore, we've reached our capacity river to river and south in Manhattan. We've only one place to go, and that's north.
Mm-hmm.
And it's our contention that they're trying to push the minority people maybe into the rivers, I'm not quite sure, or at least as far north as they can go.
Yeah.
And the pieces of property that are going to be very valuable in the near future are hospitals like Metropolitan Hospital.
And you think this is a kind of a plan? For instance, it's been said that Martin Czerkowski, who was up at Montefiore, had the new municipal hospital in the Bronx built right in the back door of Montefiore, so that could be negotiated
right.
as part of the...
And connected
these
to the
are
tunnel,
giveaways,
the
aren't they? In other words, we're not looking to save money and to give the services to the people, but rather how to hand over this city-built property and service to the voluntaries and proprietaries. I think a similar thing is going on in Queens when they're talking about negotiating with one of the Long Island hospitals. L&J, right?
Mm-hmm.
I think, you know, one of the tragic things here is that most of the people in the city of New York don't realize we have a municipal hospital system because so many of the people, the working people of the city of New York, can no longer afford hospital care. They're not covered by Medicaid, which is the very low income or poverty person. They are not covered by high-priced policies or savings that they can go in. They run out of their insurance very quickly. And those are the very people that we created a municipal hospital system for, right?
By law. Mandated by law by the City Charter of New York, mandating the Health and Hospitals Corporation to establish a city hospital system to provide excellent care for 1,400,000 people in New York who cannot afford to pay it.
That's it.
Councilwoman, I just want to say again to New Yorkers who don't think they have a stake in city hospitals.
That's right.
You never know. You have an accident and you want to go to the nearest hospital, or a heart attack. You want to go to the nearest hospital. It might save your life. You might have an older relative who has a stroke, who's in a hospital, and you want to make sure that that hospital is offering the best possible care.
Tell me, what is the rating on municipal hospitals in terms of emergency care? I think I read something about it.
They're considered to be the best emergency rooms.
Isn't that different?
They have to be, because, you see, the populations that we're servicing are a population of which emergencies are very frequent.
Would you say, some people have the impression that voluntary hospitals run by these high-priced doctors and high-priced administrators are all very good and everybody wants to run to them. How are they rated, do you think, in this emergency care type thing?
I'm sure they're good, but I don't feel they're as experienced, and they don't have the turnover that we have. At Metropolitan alone, I'm not familiar with the other statistics, but at Metropolitan, we have over 95,000 emergency room visits per year.
And therefore
that's more than any of the other voluntary hospitals on the east side.
And aren't these municipal hospitals backed up by good teaching staffs and good doctor staffs?
Absolutely.
I know at Gouverneur.
Sure.
Well, who do we have?
New York University.
And what
Medical
is the
school.
Percentage of the professional staff there, do you know? They're all doctors, qualified doctors, and
most of the, almost every single one of the hospitals, and particularly the thing that's so sad is these two hospitals that are planned to be closed, Metropolitan and Sydenham, are fully accredited.
Maximally accredited.
Yes.
By the way, the voluntaries, you see, have not gotten maximal accreditation. Some
of
them have gotten 1 year.
In other words, this is a high rating of accreditation.
There was a newspaper article just last week that Montefiore Hospital, supposedly one of the best teaching medical centers, just got a 1 year accreditation. It's a half accreditation
because
of all the problems that were found.
That the mayor is using in order to kill what is really the city's hospital service and that the majority of people in the city really need and can afford, by the way.
Can I just follow up on what Diane said about New Yorker steak?
Uh-huh.
If you've been reading the newspapers or have any sense, there are quite a few diseases that have been increasing in New York City.
Uh-huh.
Tuberculosis is one.
Right.
And if healthcare services are not available to people who would ordinarily get something like tuberculosis, New York can become a very unhealthy place to live.
I mean,
no matter what your income is.
Okay. We have a telephone call coming in. Hi, how are you?
Fine. I would like to make a comment about the analogy that was just made regarding because of the patient population coming into municipal hospitals, that the quality of care and the emergency services is excellent. That's an inaccurate analogy.
Okay. I think that what we are trying to say, and I think there are statistics, and I've read a number of articles to back it up. I think that Bellevue, for instance, was given the highest rating in one of the articles in terms because...
So was Metropolitan.
And Metropolitan was,
that's
too.
Right.
And this is because the doctors there are very experienced in certain types of emergency care for surgery
that's
and
right.
other
if
types
I'd like to interject, I disagree with the caller,
uh-huh.
and
okay.
I'll have to state why. The type of trauma that we see at Metropolitan Hospital in the emergency room is the kind of trauma that I do not think many of the voluntary hospitals see. The New York Police Department, when there are emergencies and respond to calls, bring these patients usually to the municipal hospital system.
First.
Metropolitan
right.
Hospital System is the only hospital in the city of New York that I know of with an operating room in its emergency room. And that operating room has saved many a lives
right. mm-hmm.
when the 3 minutes that are needed to get someone resuscitated or have emergency surgery was so vital that we didn't have 5 or 6 minutes to get them to the 10th floor operating rooms. Mm-hmm. That operating room has been used many a times to save many a lives, and it's one of the things that's going to go with the budget cuts.
I hope this program
hello?
Is helping.
Hello?
Hello. Yeah. I hope this program is helping dispel a number of myths about the municipal hospitals because we have experienced people here dealing with this. Yeah.
Yeah, I still choose to disagree. I am one of the members of the EMS committee who was audited at several of the municipal hospitals.
Right.
Formerly assistant director of nursing at Bellevue.
Uh-huh.
And I think that I have rather good insight into what the capabilities are. I think that Lowell Bellin was correct in 1971 when he coined the phrase the two-class system. It's fine to be treated for emergencies, and I'm not saying that Bellevue does not have excellent emergency services,
okay.
nor that Metropolitan does not.
Yeah.
However, there are existing deficits in others, as well as there are in voluntary,
right.
and I think
I'm going to limit you now because we are running out of time. I appreciate what you're saying, and there's nobody here who is not deeply involved in the weaknesses that exist in many of the municipal hospitals. I must tell you, Lowell Bellin has been one of the knives that have cut into the heart
right.
of
Thank
the municipal
you.
System. So if you are supporting his position, we would have some serious differences on this thing. I appreciate that. But thank you for calling. We appreciate it. And we hope that you will think about some of the things that you heard tonight, because it is very important that people get away from, I must tell you, down on the Lower East Side, we have a lot of very old people who have lived there for many, many years. And I remember our parents and grandparents were scared of going to hospitals, and especially to go to a place like Bellevue, which was a public hospital. Only crazy people were there and you never came out alive. This was an old myth, you see. Now we have worked with them and they have come to a municipal hospital in their own place. These hospitals, the municipal hospitals, have become the doctors for the people who live in these communities.
Right.
And they have regular doctors, don't they?
That's right. One of the plans that came down from health, education, and welfare was the fact that East Harlem and Harlem had such high incidence of diseases and was so underserved that they need clinics in addition to the hospital. The mayor's conveniently turned that around to say that instead of the hospital, let's replace
right.
it with clinics.
Right.
We need both.
That's
right. In other words, if you have a clinic, you must have the backup services for full hospital.
Absolutely.
You can't say to the poor person, you will get only a small clinic, and to those who can afford to pay, you will have a clinic with a backup hospital to it. And that is what the mayor is saying to the majority of people in the city of New York, unfortunately, with this health and hospital plan.
We've never had adequate health services,
right.
And if we had those clinics, we would probably be identifying more people with illnesses and diseases who require hospitalization.
That's right.
And that's why we have to have those hospitals.
I see that. Okay. Now, do you feel that perhaps we can get more to the people? How do the community boards feel about this? Are they kind of left out of the planning and the discussions?
Oh, yes.
How about it?
Most of the community boards, well, there were hearings called by Deputy Mayor Ward before the plan was finished, and we had nothing to react to. And they called that consultation.
That
they're
is
trying
no consultation.
To call that consultation.
Right. We feel that the people of New York need more understanding of the plan, more insight into the plan. We have tried to give you a little bit of the beginning. There's a lot of material, and if you're interested, you may call my office, and we have some available because everybody here has written material, has prepared material, and there's more available for you. I would say thank you very much to Judy Wessler, to Dr. Merlino, and to Diane Lacey. I'm Miriam Friedlander, City Councilwoman. Have a good day and good health to you.